Welcome to Unit 5.7, and welcome to the sequel of the thrilling story about the discovery of quasicrystals. We still write the year 1982. Dan Schechtman carried out an electron diffraction experiment with a new kind of alloys and perceived such a diffraction pattern. A diffraction pattern with tenfold rotational symmetry. He was convinced that he discovered something new. But in the first 2 years after his discovery, he was the only one. And probably this is not surprising, because for someone to say, "I have discovered crystal with forbidden symmetry," is somewhat similar to, "I found a planet which is a flat slice." Many of his research colleagues believed that the experiments were not carried out with sufficient care, and that the patterns he observed are some kind of artifacts. One possibility he explicitly excluded was that this pattern could result from the investigations of crystals which look like single chunks, but are in fact composed of two or more domains. This actually occurs rather often and is called twinning. One mineral which relatively often show an unusual twinning is pentagonite, a rare silicon-containing mineral, and this mineral was named according to the circumstance that the specific twinning occurring in pentagonite leads to an apparent fivefold, a pentagonal symmetry. So it looks like something with fivefold symmetry, but is in fact only composed of several single crystals, which as such show only ordinary symmetry. But again, Schechtman was a good experimentalist. He trusted his research results and he knew I investigated single crystals with forbidden symmetry. 2 years later, finally, he was able to publish his results in the journal Physical Review Letters, with the title "Metallic Phase with Long-Range Orientational Order and No Translational Symmetry." Bit by bit, and in particular with help from the theoretical side in the person of Paul Steinhardt, the discovery of Schechtman was very slowly but surely accepted in the end. And 3 years ago, in 2011, he was awarded with a Nobel Prize in Chemistry for the discovery of the quasicrystals. Interestingly, there was one famous exception. Not all believed in this new state of matter. No one less than Linus Pauling, one of the most esteemed chemists, having received the Nobel Prize twice, disagreed with Schechtman's beliefs. And this until his dying day in 1994. I just briefly mentioned Paul Steinhardt and his work with Schechtman, and this leads us to the famous Penrose tilings. We saw in the last unit that it is not possible to fill the floor or to cover the plane completely with pentagons. But in 1974, Sir Roger Penrose could show that it is possible, by choosing two special rhombi, a fat and a thin one, to cover the plane completely, and which is A, non-periodic, and B, that this pattern shows fivefold rotational symmetry. It is very interesting that this pattern has no strict periodicity. For a long time it was believed that it is not possible to cover a plane with something non-periodic. But this is true for this pattern. It is not strictly regular. It is not possible to define a certain area as the unit cell and to complete the pattern by pure translations along two directions. If you look, for instance, at the center of this tiling, we see a pattern which I marked here in a different color. And one might think that we could see this pattern again in other areas, for instance here. But this is not the case. It is very similar, that's true, but it is not identical. Yeah, this is, I think, a very strange pattern. Back to Steinhardt. He was also working on the question if a quasi-regular state of matter could give rise to diffraction patterns with icosahedral, meaning with fivefold symmetry, and he was aware of the Penrose tilings. And when he saw the work of Schechtmann, actually a preprint of this publication, he was very fascinated. He realized that Schechtmann's quasicrystals show exactly the features that he was looking for. Later, it could be shown that it is indeed possible to obtain a three-dimensional analogon of the two-dimensional Penrose tilings in which not rhombi but rhombohedra are joined together. This must resemble in a way the atomic arrangement of the Schechtmann's alloys. It is not possible to describe quasicrystals as normal crystals in three-dimensional space. However, three-dimensional quasicrystals can be described as regular formations in the six-dimensional space, which will lead us to crystallography in higher dimensions. Did I say us? Well, not me. Don't ask me anything about crystallography in higher dimensions. I find crystallography in three dimensions already tough enough. So, one question remains. Are quasicrystals now crystals or not? Well, they lack one particular feature that is characteristic for crystals: long-range translational order. How could they be crystals? On the other hand, quasicrystals do give defined diffraction patterns in diffraction experiments, and only crystals give such patterns. The International Union of Crystallography joined on the latter aspect and redefined the term crystal as: a crystal is a state of matter which causes defined Bragg peaks, diffraction spots, in a diffraction experiment. So, this was the last unit of chapter 5, and this was actually my last proper unit in this course. Now I want to hand over to Michael, who is responsible for the remaining two chapters. We consider, for instance, the question: is it possible to combine crystalline features with empty space, namely pores? Stay tuned and be curious about metal-organic frameworks and their description as nets. Thank you.